Hello, and thank you for tuning into the AI Agent Builder Summit. This is the analyst post-game show where we summarize our key takeaways from the very inspiring session we had with AgilePoint. Our goal is to highlight the core differentiators of our sponsors and to help you separate the signals from the noise. I'm Scott Hebner, the principal analyst for AI at SiliconANGLE Media and theCUBE Research, and I'm joined by Savannah Peterson, a colleague and principal analyst here at theCUBE Research, and a superstar host that you may have seen many, many, many times on theCUBE broadcasts on thecube.net. Together, we're going to tag team on what we learned from Jesse Shea, the founder and CEO of AgilePoint. So, Savannah, thanks so much for taking the time to be here today.
It's my pleasure, Scott. Happy Pride, and congratulations again on such a successful summit. I am honored that you invited me to break it all down here in the post-game show.
Yeah, I always point out to everyone when I talk about you that you're not just passionate about technology and business, but also about society. And you mentioned the Happy Pride month, so good for you.
Thanks, Scott.
Keep going.
We're all here. We're all allies here at theCUBE, so it's nice to be able to celebrate that. All right, so talk to me about what you learned.
All right, so let's, Tony, if you can bring up the analyst takeaway chart. And as I went through the session with Jesse, and I spent a lot of time with them, preparing and learning about the business, and George Gilbert's been involved with them, and a really, really interesting company with a great future ahead of them. And they are in the agentic workflow space, but they've been going at this for 20 years. And they've been trying to solve many of the problems, for 2 decades that agentic AI is now starting to solve. So they're actually really well positioned to tap into this and help customers because even though agentic AI is new, the underlying problems aren't. So what they've been able to build is a holistic abstraction layer, what George Gilbert would call the semantic layer, which is going to allow you to create truly agentic workflows that understand the meaning and the context of all the underlying data and applications. And I think that's really, really key because they're abstracting out a lot of that complexity. The second thing they do is they have a control tower that will allow you to manage and govern these workflows. And again, as we've heard consistently across many of the participants in the summit, trust is the currency of innovation. No trust, no ROI. They're taking this to heart because they're working in an enterprise, landscape, and you just have to have that to be successful. And again, they're building on many, many, many years of having putting this stuff in place. And then finally, one thing I find really great about them is they're agent agnostic, meaning that you can get agents from anywhere. You don't have to build them in AgilePoint. You can build them anywhere. They can be Salesforce, they can be IBM, they can be Semaphore.ai, you name it. They can be open source. They'll work with any agent. So you can truly go out and get best of breed, talent, if you will, in the form of digital workers and integrate them into these workflows. They're also doing a really great job in providing compatibility across the applications and the SaaS solutions and the infrastructures that customers already have in place. So you take those three things together, and I think they have a winning equation.
Yeah, I think it's interesting, even just the language around that control tower. There's a lot of, single pane of glass, mission control. Everyone, when we're talking about, really what we're talking about at our core here is observability when it comes to actually knowing what this digital workforce is up to. And that sounds silly a little bit on one hand, but on the other hand, that's one of the mission critical business challenges that companies deploying these digital forces have in front of them. I'm curious if you mentioned that they've been at this game for 20 years, and I'm curious if you got a sense for if they had been anticipating the moment that we're having right now, or if they were kind of hoping it was going to happen for the last 2 decades.
Well, I think they've been trying to do this for some time, certainly in the second half of that couple decades, but the technology around them wasn't there. And so they've been doing the AI component for some time. It's really these agentic capabilities that are now coming on the scene with all the innovation. And as you know, Savannah, if you look back at cloud and you look back at mobile and you look back at, you know, the Internet of Things, and you look back at client server, each one of these transformations, you know, the innovation cycles have sped up. And now we're in this like AI, you know, it's moving at warp speed. So every 2 years, there's these rapid innovations. And I think they've been doing a good job of keeping up.
Yeah.
And helping their customers keep up. Because if you fall behind these days, you may never catch up. Where in the cloud era, you know, you can be a little bit slower to get going because, you know, they gave you space to catch up. And so I think they've been anticipating this. And it's almost like a dream come true, if you will, that all this infrastructure is now coming to be available for them through their AI infrastructure providers and the agentic capabilities and Gen AI and all that.
Yeah, very much an intersection of preparation and opportunity moment for them, it sounds like, which is very exciting. You highlighted how they are agent agnostic and they play nice with whatever tools that you're needing to achieve your success. You have some data on this, right?
I do, actually. Let's bring up, Tony, that next chart. And this is some of the data that they had provided, but I can tell you McKinsey recently came out with a study that had a very similar point to it, which is that bottom one on the left. Let's talk about that first. That the large majority of businesses plan to have a mix of building their own proprietary agents, right? And then acquiring agents on the open marketplace that meet their needs that they then customize and integrate in. And then, of course, all the SaaS applications that they already have installed, they're going to start providing agents. So you actually have three sources of agents. You got agent marketplaces, you got the SaaS providers that are going to decompose those applications into agents, and then you got the ones you're going to build in-house. And I think the number one thing people should be looking to as they start to implement agentic AI is you want that choice and, you know, choice and flexibility. It has to be open and interoperable so you can get best of breed agents regardless of where they come and bring them together. And you can see already that most businesses don't want to build their own agents. They only want to build the ones that are truly differentiated for their business or proprietary in some nature.
Totally. Yeah. Or for that, you know, highly sensitive information or certain systems. I agree. I mean, I think we're at a really unique stage where it's not only advantageous but imperative to not be reinventing the wheel every time you do something right now if you want any chance whatsoever of keeping up with the velocity of innovation during this era. So I think that actually makes a lot of sense. And it's a conversation that you and I were having earlier a little bit too, is I find myself using so many different tools all the time, and it's where I am. It's meeting me where I am, not me going to have to right. find it. And I think what they're trying to do is, you know, put the bumpers on that bowling lane or define that sandbox where these companies can play and succeed, but not have to necessarily pick a favorite right now. And I think that's critical. I mean, nobody even knows what the next few months are going to look like.
You mentioned the bowling lane. Did you know I was on the Junior Bowlers Tour? You probably don't.
Scott, I did not know that, but that is a gem of an anecdote. So you're just a seriously competitive bowler?
Yeah, it was the junior. And then I, you know, I didn't have the concentration levels. I mean, I think I was, you know, I think I was averaging like 205 a game or something like that. Yeah, but I just, you know, I get to the pressure situation. You have to be really consistent in bowling, and I just wasn't able to do that. I'm a little bit an anxious guy, you know, type A, I think they say, and that's not a good match to being a bowler.
Oh my gosh. Okay. First of all, we absolutely have to go bowling sometime. I cherish that you just shared this. And now I'm going to keep the bowling analogies coming moving forward.
There you go.
But this is a win.
But Tony, if you bring back the chart, let me kind of tap on going to where they are. Your point, Savannah, which is that top one, which is 90% of businesses, they want these agentic systems and the agents to tap into existing systems, right? They very much favor a hybrid approach here of new capabilities, but you have to bring what you have forward with you. And that taps very well into what AgilePoint has been doing over the years, which is really excelling at the cross workflow integration, the cross application, the cross infrastructure in terms of data. So you look at both of these proof points here, both the mix of agents and the ability to tap into existing infrastructure or new infrastructure that you buy or applications, I think they covered the bases in both of those.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. Makes a lot of sense. Cool. Wow. Okay, so what do you think they're going to do next?
Well, actually, let me bring up one more chart that I pulled together here.
Great.
And Tony can bring that up here. And this is a interoperability framework that the Q Research had built, that I built, I guess I should say. And it was designed to help evaluate how open and interoperable the agentic AI frameworks are. And it looked at the five criteria that you see on the left, right? Semantic layer support, open protocols, LLMs, and APIs, so you have choice. Are you able to cross orchestrate agents? You know, how well are you supporting extensible adapters? And then the ability to compose, different agents into workflows and adapt them easily and all that stuff. And when you look at this, you can see some of the players on the right-hand side here. AgilePoint fares extremely well. They're one of the leaders in that space. So I think, again, on my bullish list is AgilePoint. I think they're doing all the right things that are going to meet what clients are going to need, businesses are going to need in the future, which the trusted environment, the extensible environment, the choice of agents to plug in. I think they're heading in the right direction.
I think so, too. It sounds like it. And it looks like the data certainly reflects that as well. Exciting time for them.
Yeah. And, I mentioned that they're not far from you out there. You should go see them one of these days. Actually, they're
Love
right.
You.
They're 5 minutes from the studio there. And, Jesse, when I was out there doing the summit, he took me out to a great sushi restaurant. We had a really great time. So he's a great, great guy and, incredibly smart and in tune with what his customers are doing. So we'll have to get you guys together one of these days.
Yeah, we'll have to get you out too, Scott. We can do a little reunion. You can introduce me to all your fun AI agent friends.
Yeah, I'm due for a trip out there.
Yeah.
All right, Savannah, thank you once again for being here. I really, really appreciate it. Sure. These summits are dedicated to really focusing on what these vendors are able to accomplish that many others aren't. And I want to encourage everyone to make sure you get out and watch the interviews, and in particular, in this case, watch AgilePoint. I think you will find it incredibly intriguing. And you can also visit thecube.net to get access to the videos, interviews, as well as a dedicated portal for AgilePoint where you can learn a lot more about their business. I think it'd definitely be worth your time. So again, thank you all for taking your time to be here. We are the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis. Bye for now.